As you know, this class is composed of the doctrine of man, sin, and salvation. We're very close to wrapping up the section on the doctrine of man. As a matter of fact, we're looking at the issue of the end of human life, which we started on page 50. I think yesterday we ended with the different perspectives on the end of human life. On page 50, we talked about, some have held that the soul continues, but the body does not. That's more of a Platonic sort of thought. We also did say that though that there are some who are within the Protestant liberal tradition who held that view. There's also cessationism, which would obviously be connected with more of a secular view where there's no afterlife at all. Annihilationism, which will be that eternal life is something that is bestowed upon by God but not necessarily inherent, so thus unbelievers can be snuffed out of existence, their soul sleep, reincarnation. Then the one that we were affirming yesterday was the entrance into the intermediate state. So we were making the case yesterday that when a person dies, their body goes into the ground, their spirit either goes to be with the Lord if they're a believer in paradise or the third heaven. If a person's not a believer, their soul would go to be in Hades, which appears to be like a temporary place of torment before the lake of fire. And I think where we really left off yesterday was looking at that Revelation 6, verses 9 to 11, which is I think that's my favorite intermediate state passage, because again, it shows people clearly who were killed because they were believers in Christ. They gave their life because they were saved and they were faithful. Obviously, their bodies stayed in the ground. Their souls went up to the presence of the Lord. And they were, when they got up there, we said that, even though they're not glorified, they have some sort of body-like existence without it being a resurrection body. They were able to, first of all, be identified when they showed up in heaven. They were able to speak. They were crying out with a loud voice. They were clothed with a white robe. They were told to wait a little while longer, which I think is important to understand that even in the intermediate state, there's the sense that the destiny of man is back towards the planet, not just living up in heaven forever. A lot of Christians in general have the impression that the goal of the believer someday is to fly away to heaven and just stay in the intermediate heaven forever. That's not the case. You get to Revelation 19 and 20, Jesus Christ comes down to earth, he establishes his kingdom. When you get to Revelation 21 and 22, at that point you even have God, the presence of the whole Trinity on the earth at that point. The New Jerusalem has the throne of God and of the Lamb in it. So, one of the things that I guess we mentioned here on biblical perspectives on death is because of the fall, because of sin, which we will be getting into today, there ends up being a temporary temporary separation between the material and the immaterial part of a person. We've talked about that. When God originally created man, he created him as a complex unity of material and immaterial, of body and soul. But because of death, there ends up being that temporary separation. So that's taking place, once you just read Genesis 4 and 5 and Cain and Abel, and then eventually the genealogies where it's mentioned everybody died. You have these, that obviously is the norm, where people will have a separation of their body and their spirit. Of course, there ends up being some rare examples of that, like Elijah being taken up. But on the whole, that's the normal experience. So in one sense, we ask, is death natural or unnatural? And I guess the answer is depends on how you look at it. Certainly from the perspective of thousands of years of human existence, it's natural in the sense that, we haven't seen the resurrection of all take place yet. So there ends up being physical death. In one sense, though, it's unnatural in the sense that that's not really what man was created for. Obviously, we see that when you get to Genesis 2:15 to 17, that there's the when man was first created, there's that opportunity to rebel and thus to die. But technically, man's not created to die. And we know that when we get to the to the resurrection and into the eternal state, that everybody is a complex unity again of material and immaterial. But obviously, death is something that is, hangs over the head of mankind until this age. Hebrews 2:15 does indicate that Jesus has broken the power of death. So I guess in the sense when it comes to that, there's some already not yet implications in the sense that Christ has defeated death. He's come out of the grave. According to 1 Corinthians 15, he's the first fruits of the resurrection. Those who have identified with him and believed in him are going to also experience resurrection someday. See, did I pass out the attendance sheet? I can't remember if I did or not. Okay, already. Sometimes I forget to do that. So, all right. Let's see. See, coming to page 53, the Bible discusses three types of death. Part of the reason why I'm not going into more depth on this is I think we cover this more extensively in Theology 4 with individual eschatology. But the Bible discusses three types of death: spiritual death, physical death, and eternal death. Spiritual death is for those who are they're physically alive, but spiritually separated from God. Ephesians 2:10 talks about, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. I think when Adam and Eve sinned, they became spiritually separated from God. So then there's physical death. Physical death occurs, obviously, when there's the cessation of critical biological functions. There's been some discussion throughout the ages as far as what actually constitutes death, whether it's just the heart stopping or it's brain death. But the main thing there would be cessation of critical biological functions. And then there would be eternal death. Eternal death would exist for those who are spiritually dead and then physically die in that state. So if somebody is spiritually dead and they physically die, then they would enter eternal death. Because we're told that, it's appointed unto man once to die, and after this comes judgment. We don't believe that there's second chances after physical death. What comes after death? So you mentioned the intermediate state occurs, in which the soul / spirit exist in recognizable spirit form. Some of the Old Testament passages talk about being with God. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 verse 7 refers to the spirit, says the spirit returns to God who gave it. In Luke chapter 9 and Matthew chapter 17, I think the event of the transfiguration, you have Moses and Elijah who appear with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. So it seems to indicate there that they are alive. Luke chapter 16, verses 19 to 31. That's the account of the rich man and Lazarus. And it might be worth looking at just briefly here. There's obviously a lot of debate on this issue as whether it's a parable or indicating real life events. I tend to view it as being more than just a parable, particularly since it seems to be consistent with other known truths that we know about the intermediate state, plus the fact that you do have specific names that are being mentioned here. Jesus says in Luke 16:19, it says, "Now there was a rich man, and he habitually dressed in purple and fine linen, joyously living in splendor every day. And a poor man named Lazarus was laid at his gate, covered with sores, longing to be fed from the rich man's table." Verse 22 says, "Now the poor man died and was carried away by the angels to Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried. In Hades he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and saw Abraham far away and Lazarus in his bosom." So it's interesting here you have the mention of both of these men dying, one of them going to Abraham's bosom, but the rich man going to Hades, and notice it mentions him being in torment, but it still indicates self-consciousness and existence here because it says he saw Abraham far away and Lazarus in his bosom. Notice also too that he cried out and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus so that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue, for I am in agony in this flame. So, you know, again here, this, I think this would parallel the Revelation 6, 9 to 11 in some instances, in the sense that you do have an intermediate state here, and there seems to be a self-consciousness. In other words, neither in this or the Revelation 6 passage do we find the people in their intermediate state saying, you know, who am I? You know, it seems like they understand at least somewhat of what's going on. It seems to be recognition of others. He knows who Father Abraham is. He knows who Lazarus is. Appears to be in torment, asking for relief. So, you know, just even the language used here, you know, the asking that Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water, cool off my tongue in the agony. Now, like I said, it's hard to go into specific details of the intermediate state body, but it's clearly not a resurrection body. I mean, we know that. But it also seems to be more than just non-existence. I mean, it appears to be more than just a wispy sort of ghostly experience. There seems to be some sort of, I don't know what to call it, perhaps other than like some body-like aspects to it. Verse 25, but Abraham said, child, remember that during your life you received your good things and likewise Lazarus bad things, but now he is being comforted here and you are in agony. What I think is interesting about that account too is that Abraham is appealing to memory at this particular point. Again, a lot of people, again, I'm just playing kind of to the stereotypical understanding, but a lot of people think that when you get into, quote, after death, that you get the big memory erase, have absolutely no cognition or memory of anything that happened before. I mean, that doesn't appear to be the case here. It's interesting that Abraham is actually reminding him of what took place on the earth. So I think there's continuity. Now again, I know there's other passages that say that the former things will be remembered no more, but I don't think that contextually is so much about memory erase as it is about the feeling the pains and the experience of a fallen world. I think that's primarily what that's referring to, and I would also probably take that to mean that the perhaps some of the things that may torment us or, you know, bring agony to our lives in regard to memories and experiences and those sorts of things won't have that negative impact in the future. So I personally do think that in the intermediate state and the millennium and the new earth, that we do, that there ends up being memories, there ends up being, you know, some sort of understanding what happened in the past, because, you know, we're products of history, we're products of Genesis 1 and 2 and of the fall and of what Christ has done for us. And I don't think we're going to be, you know, looking at Christ and seeing those marks in his hands and saying, why did that happen? Or what's that about? You know, there's going to be, I think, some recognition of basic things of history there. So verse 26, besides all this, between us and you, there's a great chasm fixed that those who wish to come over from here to you will not be able, that they may not cross over from here to there. Then you have the, so obviously is indicating different destinies for people. Verse 28, you know, rich man goes on to say, I have five brothers in order that he may warn them so that they will not also come to this place of torment. So he's obviously recognizing that he still had brothers and want to warn them. And basically the answer given to him was that, you know, there's Moses and the prophets to listen to. And if they're not going to listen to the word of God, which is the ultimate authority, they won't be listening to these other things. So, like I said, this is a debated passage as far as whether it's just a pure parable or not. Like I said, I think it's more than that because of the names, because of the details of the situations here, and particularly since there's much here that you can find parallels with, like I said, even in the Revelation 6 passage and others, that I tend to think that it's describing a realistic situation. Okay, page 54. We know in Luke chapter 23, verse 43, one of the thieves on the cross says, Lord, remember me when you enter your kingdom. Jesus says, you know, today you will be with me in paradise. So now we know that, you know, both of their bodies are going to be physically dead shortly, but that's indicating conscious existence in paradise. Acts chapter 7, Acts chapter 7, Stephen is being stoned, and It says that Stephen's spirit was received into heaven after he was martyred. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, Paul said that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Philippians 1, 22 to 24, Paul said that to depart and be with Christ is much better than living in the physical realm. And so it is, I think the doctrine of the intermediate state is very, very well established. Then there's a coming resurrection of the body, which again, this does intersect with theology for eschatology sorts of issues, but just to make a few comments on that, I think it's important to understand again that the we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Now we do live in a fallen world, and in a fallen world there's death, but again, you be making your connections here between Genesis 1 to 2 and then Revelation 20 to 22, because remember, Adam was made, formed from the dust of the ground, he was made with the body. God breathed into him the breath of life, so Adam's body mattered. The creation, including the physical body, was deemed to be very good. So, of course, there's been an assault on that understanding from Greek philosophy, particularly Platonism, Gnosticism, Neoplatonism, and, of course, from the Eastern religions, Hinduism and Buddhism and all that, which seem to have a lesser view of the physical body. The Christian worldview is affirming the goodness of the body. It's also looking forward. The Christian worldview is emphasizing the restoration of all things. So there's much discussion in the scripture, telling about the resurrection of the body. Even in Job 19:26, there's a statement there that I know from my, my Redeemer lives, and from my flesh I will see the Redeemer. Isaiah 26, verse 19 is talking about physical resurrection. So is Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. The Daniel 12 passage talks about after the time of tribulation, there will be those who will be called from the graves, both the righteous and the unrighteous. John chapter 5, verses 28 to 29, Jesus seems to be relying on the truth of Daniel 12, 2. There's going to come a day where both the wicked and the righteous will hear the voice of the Lord and will come out of the grave. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 goes into great detail about the coming body. In other words, 1 Corinthians 15 is going to be affirming physical resurrection. I mean, we know from 1 Corinthians 15, 20 and following that Christ is the first fruits of the resurrection. And we know that he came out bodily. We know that they could, touch me, see that I'm not a ghost. But he has flesh, he has bones. So there's a sense in which he's the template of our resurrection body. You do find some references in the 1 Corinthians passage to that it's a spiritual body. And some have stumbled over the meaning of the spiritual body in 1 Corinthians 15. Some say, Adam had a physical body, but now in the resurrection we have a spiritual body, almost like just a ghost-like body. But I think the key there, I think when you're looking at it in its context here, is Paul is not contrasting matter with spirit, but he's contrasting those of us in the line of Adam in the sense of the fall with decaying mortal bodies compared with the spiritual body that we will be getting. So to me, when 1 Corinthians 15 talks about having a spiritual body, that's a physical body of which its origin is from heaven. So I think the key issue there is more of origin and source as opposed to its spirit, as opposed to matter. Just like when Jesus talks about, the kingdom of heaven all over the place in Matthew, and he's saying, the meek will inherit the earth, but he's also talking about the kingdom of heaven. When he talks about the kingdom of heaven, he's not just saying the kingdom equals heaven, but it's the kingdom which comes from heaven, which is relying on the Daniel 2 message of the stone that is made without hands. In other words, it's spiritual in origin. It comes, shatters the earthly kingdoms, and then itself is a kingdom upon the earth. So all I'm getting at here is when you see the reference to the spiritual body in 1 Corinthians 15, that doesn't mean immaterial. It means its source is from heaven. It will be a glorified body of which its source is heaven, but it's still physical. Yes?
Being as a seed,
yeah,
or it's like a seed of grain. What do you think that refers to?
I think that goes back to the idea that there's some eschatology even from Genesis 1 in the sense that I think it was God's plan for this would be my view. I would say when God created man, he created him to fulfill the kingdom mandate and to do it successfully on his behalf. And I do think that there's a reward for that. So I think in the sense of making the comparison between the first body in the line of Adam and then the glorified body, that, so in other words, that's what I think it is. Because I think there is some sort of an intended eschatology there, that there's intended to be a transition from what the conditions of what you would see in Genesis 1 to 2 to what you would see like in Revelation 21 and 22. I mean, which brings up an issue. You know, when we talk about the restoration of all things, I'm broadening it out here. If we were to ask ourselves, like when we look at Revelation 21 and 22, is that the same or better than what Genesis 1 and 2 was like? I think most of us would say that it's better, in the sense of that God's what God is doing is a restoration of all things, but it's not. God's goal isn't just to get us back to the conditions of Genesis 1 and 2. Obviously, that's part of it, but it's also grander than that. So all of that to say, I think there's a sense in which the glorified state ends up coming after the first form, as we're in the line and form of Adam. We transition from that, so it's kind of like a seed to the full flower, I guess. All right, any other thoughts on anything we've covered so far? 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 to 17 talks about the fact that, remember the Thessalonians were concerned that they had loved ones who died who weren't going to be a part of the rapture event. And he says the Lord, he's going to bring them when he comes again. We're going to be with them to meet the Lord in the air. Just talking about a resurrection and a glorification. Like I said, I wanted to touch on this here, but we get a lot more into that at Theology 4 when we get into the resurrections and the glorification and all that sort of thing. But I guess the big takeaway is that the body does matter and it's heading for glorification. So I think I told you with a little bit of a wink and a smile that when you're doing funerals and maybe resist the temptation to say the body's just a shell. Yeah, it's true. I think in the context of that person has moved on to be with the Lord, that it is, there is a sense in which the shell analogy is true. But in reality, that body is not, quote, just a shell. That body was fearfully and wonderfully made, and it's headed for glorification. And that's the full picture. So, all right. Any questions on anything we've discussed so far? All right, so that brings us to transition point to the doctrine of sin. So let's do our little 5-minute synopsis of the doctrine of man. Let's hit the high points. So when it comes to the doctrine of man, we're going to say that Genesis 1 to 26 to 28 is the foundational anthropology passage. Again, I've just become convinced that as you're thinking through a theology and a biblical theology, almost for everything, make sure you understand Genesis 1, 26 to 28. It starts with God, the God who is both unity and diversity, who says, let us make man in our image. So man is a creation of God. Man is a creature. He owes his allegiance to the Creator. So, we see that man is made in the image and likeness. And we talked about that image. We talk about being made in the image of God. There's ways in which man is like God, ways in which man represents God. We talked about kingship implications from the image. There's a sense in which, like I said, in the ancient Near East, sometimes a leader or a king would put an image of himself in an area which would represent his control and domination of that area. Man is not just a statue, he's a living, breathing person, but he's supposed to be a person who represents God on the earth. So he's made as a king, which also means that he's a mediator. He's supposed to rule the earth on God's behalf. He's to rule and subdue it. The fact that he's in the likeness of God indicates that he's a son and that he's made in relationship with God. And I guess you could say because he is a son, he will He is intended to rule as a king. So, you know, when we see the image and likeness, we're obviously seeing, in a sense, the essence of man. The essence of man, the ontology, the who he is. We do believe that the image of God is related to the essence of man. It's not just function or not just relationship, although those are important. But it is also important, you know, it is important too that man is given a function. He is to, you know, he is to multiply, and he is also to rule and subdue. That is his mandate. That is, some call it the cultural mandate, some call it the creation mandate. I prefer to call it a kingdom mandate. That is what his man is supposed to do. And also what we saw too from this particular passage is that he is meant for relationship. Man is relational to the core, and therefore he's to have a relationship with, you know, God primarily, and then with other humans, and then with the creation. So as a matter of fact, if I'm thinking through what I view as the overarching theme and purpose of Scripture, you know, I would say, first of all, the purpose of everything is for the glory of God. But as God wants that done, it's going to be with the theme of kingdom in the context of relationships. So kingdom of God is theme. And as that's occurring, it's in the realm of these thriving relationships of relationship to God, humans, and creation. So, you know, we also talked about some other things, you know, that when it comes to the essence of man, there's a sense in which he's a complex unity of the body and then the soul / spirit. There's also a sense too, in regard to this essence, that there's, you know, there's male and female. So I think these give us really the, in a nutshell, the main things about man. Structurally, he's image and likeness of God. He's a king. He's a son. He's made of body and spirit in a complex unity. The image of God also includes the male, female, how that's supposed to work together. And then man's function is to multiply and rule and subdue the earth, and then to have thriving relationships within these three. So I think in a nutshell, that's the main thing of Genesis 1 and 2. That's who he is. The more you understand this, the more devastated you will be with the fall. So that's what come, as I heard one person say one time, let's not just be so quick to run to Genesis 3. Let's live in Genesis 1 and 2 for a while. Let's think about that, what God intended, what man was supposed to be, what he's supposed to do. And then when you get to the fall, then you can really appreciate the horror of the fall, which will make you appreciate more what Jesus does as the last Adam and what the coming restoration of all things will be. So, I've heard it said before, and I would agree that, you know, if you're going off the 4-point story, I actually believe there's 5 because I like to include a promise. But if you're going off of creation, fall, you know, redemption, and then restoration. You know, if this is 1, 2, 3, 4. I remember reading one author who was saying, and I thought it was actually a pretty good impression. Of course, as I make this, I think there would be exceptions. There would be exceptions to this, but on the whole, this person was saying that oftentimes evangelicals are really good at 2 and 3. They really got that down, and rightfully so. But we also have to have a good understanding of 1 and 4. And I would even just say personally, experientially, I find myself that as I understand Genesis 1 to 2 more, I have a greater appreciation for 2 and 3, and then even 4 as well. So let's, again, make sure that we have a proper understanding of all 4 parts of the story. All right, was that 5 minutes? Is that the 5-minute nutshell summary there? So, but anyway, that's foundational. That's, we can't stress enough how important Genesis 1 and 2 is for our understanding. And then I would even broaden that out to Genesis 1 to 11. obviously that you're going to see the fall, sin, the promise come into play. So I would even just say, I'd be experientially, just even as a parent, you know, as I look at my kids that are teenagers and below teenager, just as I want them to know the Christian worldview, I find myself in Genesis 1 to 11 more than ever. Just like we really got to grasp, I think, a lot of the biblical worldview that we should have for addressing a lot of the social issues today, the gender confusion, beginning of life confusion, all that sort of stuff. A lot of the answers come in Genesis 1 to 11. All right, any last call on anthropology? Okay. All right, let's move over to, now we turn the page to Genesis 3. Hopefully we have a good understanding of Genesis 1 and 2, what it means for anthropology. Now we turn the page to Genesis 3. And I think in the notes, I guess we start around page 58. I think 58 technically is where the doctrine of sin comes into play systematically. So I think what we'll do here is, remember, I think on the first day of class I ended up doing kind of like a biblical theology of man in 10 steps. I'm going to do something like that here by doing a theology of sin from Genesis 1 to 11. So you do have this on your course homepage, so if you wanted to look at it there. So like I said, to go back kind of what we want to do with this class is it's a systematic theology class. We're looking at theological categories, but we also want to make sure we understand how the biblical theology part plays into it. So what would be a thumbnail sketch of the doctrine of sin from Genesis 1 to 11? Again, why am I picking Genesis 1 to 11? Because again, that's the section where God's dealing with mankind generally, whereas when you get to Genesis 12, after that, it seems to focus mostly on the developing nation of Israel through the Old Testament. So if we're going to look at biblical theology of sin, we certainly would want to take into account what we covered as far as who man is. But then I think Genesis 2, 15 to 17 will be key, because with Genesis 2, 15 to 17, we do see the potential for sin existed with the test. The test of Genesis 2, 15 to 17. We have all these, you know, well, first of all, you know, we've been given the description of the whole creation in Genesis 1. Genesis 2 now focuses more narrowly on day 6 with the creation of the man and the woman. Now you do have the man created at this point, but when you come to verse 15, it says, "Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it," which again seems to be pretty consistent with the idea he made him to work. That probably would be connected to the rule and subdue at this particular point, specifically linked to the Garden of Eden. And then in verse 16, "The Lord God commanded the man, saying, 'From any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it you shall surely die.'" So there ends up being this test here. I mean, Adam has all of these trees that he could eat from, perhaps even including the tree of life. There's a little bit of debate on theologians on that. There's no consensus. Was Adam and Eve eating from the tree of life before the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? There's some discussion on that. But anyway, there is a test here. "When it comes to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it, you shall surely die." So there ends up being a tree that they are not to eat from. We don't get an explicit discussion what the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is, but it appears to be linked perhaps to the concept of autonomy and deciding for oneself what's right and wrong, which the right answer would be from the creator-creature distinction. We understand that the creator is the only one who has true autonomy. The creature is supposed to interpret the world in light of what the creator has said, not take matters into his own hands. That's what ends up happening with Adam and Eve. Yeah, we know God said this, but this is looking pretty good to us, and we're going to We think God's holding out a little bit, so we're going to take things into our own hands. So there is a test here, and you know, there's the promise, there's the statement there that, you know, if you eat of it, you shall surely die. So I would say that the test here seems to have implications in regard to man being made a person. You know, he's a creature, but he's also a person. Seems to be with person. There's the concept of volition. There's the concept of will. You know, we understand in a fallen world, there's the bondage of the will. But there's a sense in which things are a little bit different at this point because the fall has not occurred. Seems to be in order for, you know, with man being a volitional being, there needs to be some sort of test here. So I think we can agree on that. I think everybody's going to agree that there's the potential for sin existed with Genesis 2, 15 to 17. Where there is disagreement, and we may even get into it later today, but I'm not going to get into it right now. But the implications of the test, there's a lot of debate on it. This is, for those who hold to a covenant of works, some would say that this is the basis for a covenant of works, where Adam needs to, if he obeys and passes the test, there's a sense in which he could merit or obey or, as the title would say, works, via works, a covenant of works, in a sense, pass the test and have salvation or glorification at that particular point. So there's a lot of debate on that particular issue. I think I've told you before, I'm not a real big fan of the covenant of works. First of all, I'm not seeing this referred to as a covenant. I think covenants used pretty strategically in the Bible. I understand you don't always have to have a word in order for a concept to be there, but it does seem like Brit's pretty strategic in how it's used. Plus, I guess what I would just say is I would go back to man created as image and likeness. Son indicates relationship. I would say that I think Adam's in relationship at this point. And so, and I know there's different versions of the covenant of works, but I wouldn't necessarily have to see him working his way to salvation because I would see he's already in relationship with God. Genesis 3 will indicate that he was walking with God in the garden before the fall took place. So, plus I guess what I would say too is I would tend to view the Genesis 2, 15 to 17 more in light of Genesis 1, 26 to 28 and see this more in relation to the kingdom mandate and the function of what he's supposed to do as opposed to a working one's way to salvation. So I probably see it more from a kingdom lens than a soteriological lens. So there's no doubt as the test is failed that there's going to be death and immediately spiritual death and then ensuing physical death that will take place from that. So I think we can all agree that there's a test. There's the, at least at this point, there's the possibility for sin. Whether this is a work salvation or covenant of works, some think there is, some think there's not. I would tend to say that it's not a covenant of works. But there are a lot of interesting issues that are implied in here. I mean, I guess one of the issues would be, you know, if Adam, let's say that he passes the test, does this test last forever? In other words, is that, you know, with this, let's just say that Adam continues to not disobey God and obey, would there ever come a point where that test wouldn't be there? Well, it's kind of speculation. It's speculation. I mean, I tend to think not. I mean, I think when you look at the glorified state of Revelation 21 and 22, that it seems like man is confirmed in holiness with no potential for sin. So I don't think that that test would exist forever and ever and ever and ever. My personal view would be is that, again, the test here is not so much works salvation, but man fulfilling the kingdom mandate of the function and the relationships. And I'm okay with the idea of there being some sort of eschatology in Genesis 1 and 2, that when if man fills and rules and subdues and does those three relationships right, that there's some sort of reward after that. I mean, I'm open to that. I'm not dogmatic on that, but I'm open to that. In a sense, that could be what the eternal state is all about. I mean, I tend to view the millennium after Christ comes again as the fulfillment of these very things. I mean, when you look at the, does man rule and subdue the earth during that particular time? He absolutely does. Jesus is the ultimate last Adam. He reigns over the earth. Revelation 5:10 says the saints are reigning over the earth. There may even be implications for the multiply command. I mean, of course, there's multiplication going on today, and some will say that is the one command that man has kept, is the filling the earth. But there also ends up being something about the millennium. I mean, read Isaiah 65, it talks about the fact that they will not bear children for calamity. I mean, in a fallen world, there's all kinds of infant mortality and death associated with that, but in the millennial kingdom, you won't have that. So I actually think there's even implications for the childbearing in the millennial kingdom. And then, of course, for those who know the Lord, those three relationships are going to be functioning right. So the millennial kingdom is the spotlight is on Jesus, the ultimate man, the last Adam. He gets glory in the realm. First of all, the realm that rejected him at his first coming. Remember also, too, that the millennium is the time period where the last Adam succeeds from and over the realm where the first Adam failed. Which, again, why I have a problem with some of the other millennial views, because they want to make the successful reign of the last Adam from heaven over a spiritual kingdom, or at least all millennialism does. So anyway, when we look at the millennium and compare it with the eternal state seems to be even greater than the millennium. So it would seem to me, 1 Corinthians 15 says Jesus must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet, and then he hands the kingdom over to the Father. So I think it's really in the millennium, and particularly at the end of the millennium, where everything that man was supposed to do is totally fulfilled. It's because of Christ. If you identify with him, you participate that, but then there's the glories of the eternal state. So could you call the eternal state a reward for the successful millennial reign? I mean, again, not dogmatic on that, but I tend to think that's the case. Okay. We'll talk more about the covenant of works idea later. As a matter of fact, I'll take you to Hokema, who makes some strong arguments against the concept of a covenant of works. Okay, that leads us to the second idea on the chart. A fallen creature enters to tempt God's image bearers. And so, Genesis 3:1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made, and he said to the woman, "Indeed has God said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden." Now you get some debate here. You know, some want to say that the focus is, you know, this isn't Satan, it's just focusing on the serpent. I think there's something behind the serpent. Not only does later Revelation tell us that, but this is a dark figure coming on the scene. That's what I would say, that when you, I mean, if we go off the creation, fall, redemption, restoration, I mean, there's a sense, obviously, where this is right. I mean, Romans 5:12 says it's from one man that sin and death entered the world. It doesn't say through the fall of Satan. But the very fact that you have this darkness come on the scene with the testing of God's words indicates that there's some... It seems to indicate to me that this is a fallen being. Now that automatically gets you into, okay, well, where does the scripture talk about that? And like I said, then you get into the debate of Ezekiel 28 and Isaiah 14, which talks about, you know, I personally think that is a description of the fall of Satan. I know there's initially discussion there of a human being, a human king, but then I think the descriptions go beyond the human king in those passages. And so I think you see several times in Scripture where you can end up having a person or a animal, in a sense, be the vehicle for a higher power. I mean, even with Matthew 16, you know, Peter's telling Jesus, "I don't like this cross stuff," and Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan." So he's talking to Peter, but Satan's the source behind the statement. And so I think it's possible that even as a human king is directed, it could go to a power behind it. But my main point here is that this is a, you know, from the very least, we understand later canonical revelation is going to refer to Satan as a serpent and those things. And I think you're hard pressed to not see him in Genesis 3. So a fallen creature enters to tempt God's image bearers. And then, of course, with Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve failed their responsibility to God and the kingdom mandate because the fall occurred. Now, I'm not going to go into a whole lot in Genesis 3 now, because we will go through Genesis 3 fairly shortly. I'm just trying to give you a big picture perspective right here. But Clearly, the Eve is fascinated with the tree. Genesis 3:6 says the tree was good for food. It was a delight to the eyes. The tree was desirable, so she took from its fruit, she ate it, and she gave it to her husband, and he ate. So at this particular point, this is the first sin of the human era. This is like I said, Romans 5:12. We'll talk about that. It ends up being through the one man that sin and death entered the world. At this particular case, Adam and Eve did what I think is at the essence of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They took moral autonomy into their own hands. They wanted to determine for themselves what was right and wrong. The serpent had placed the idea that, hey, has God really said this? I think God's holding out on you. And so Adam and Eve are like, you know, we're going to do this our way. And in doing so, acted autonomously, and we'll face the consequences for it. Next thing that we'll see in Genesis 3 is the curse. Like I said, we'll get more into the specifics of the curse. But Genesis 3, there's obviously a curse upon the instrument that Satan uses upon the serpent. There's also the promise, has multiple implications, but one of them is that the power behind the serpent is going to experience a defeat from a coming seed of the woman, which we would say canonically refers to, we know that that'll refer to Christ. And then, of course, man will experience curse. The creation will work against him. We know that the woman's going to have to give children in with hardship. So I think it's accurate to say that because of the fall, all three of these relationships suffer. Man becomes spiritually dead to God. When it comes to humans, you get into a little bit of the debate of the issue of when God tells the woman, your desire shall be for your husband, but he shall rule over you. There's some debate as to whether that's physical desire for procreation. Thus, there's the promise of childbirth's going to be hard, but still the woman is going to desire intimacy with her husband. The other view would be is that it's indicating a tension within the relationship, that there's somewhat of a power struggle. And I tend to lean towards the latter, but there's debate on that. And then, of course, with the creation, thorns and thistles are going to work against the man. The man was supposed to rule and subdue. He's supposed to cultivate and keep. Now this planet he's working at is going to frustrate him. And not only that, it will swallow him up because he was made from the dust, and the dust he's going to return. So I think pretty much all men from that point onward understand, at least to some degree, creation working against us. All right, next step would be Genesis chapter 4. You have the Cain and Abel account. So, I mean, we're not getting very far in the human race. Ham and Eve have two children, and now we have a murder between the one and the other. And so, obviously, sinfulness has taken root. I would also say, too, that there's a sense in which that is a murder is a violation of the multiply and fill command. I mean, man's supposed to multiply and fill, not kill image bearers, but to multiply. So, and when you think at that particular time, how many human beings there are at that point, and for one to be taken, that's a pretty big deal. I mean, you're taking out a quarter of the human race at that point. Yeah.
The issue of, God's law being written on the Gentile's heart.
Yeah.
And this is before the Mosaic law. So you think that at this point in time also that there's the conscience issue.
Yeah,
we know this is wrong.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, because just even his the way that he's reacting after it with in regard to God shows that there's understanding of wrong and all. But yeah, but totally. Totally Romans 2, 14 to 15, works of the law written on the heart. Conscience bearing witness. I mean, we're going to see, because God is God, there's always, in a sense, going to be certain eternal standards expected for his creatures. Sometimes the codification of that will take different forms, Mosaic law, law of Christ, whatever, but there's going to be certain transcendent expectations. But yeah, I totally agree with that. All right. So anyway, Genesis 4, like I said, we have the murder. It's probably worth looking at Genesis 4, 7. Where God says to Cain, I'll start in verse 6, the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry and why has your countenance fallen? if you do well, will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door, and its desire is for you, but you must master it. So it's interesting there. Just God is talking about this sin crouching at the door. Its desire is for you, even though that you must master it. You know, it's indicating that man has a relationship to that. He's supposed to respond right. I mean, I think as we canonically look at our theological implications, we're going to know there's nothing within man to deal with that or to master it, which eventually he's going to have to anticipate the new covenant when it comes to inner enabling. And, okay. All right, next one, number six. We have a genealogy of death because of sin, Genesis 5. So, like I said, Genesis 5 sometimes is flyover country when you're reading your Bible, because so-and-so lived, and then he died, and so-and-so lived, and then he died. And so it's kind of like the table of nations in Genesis 10 to 11. You tend to kind of view it as flyover country, but it's very significant. I guess just the thing to, you know, as you're looking at this particular passage, you know, you just start seeing all these references to people dying. You know, verse 8, Seth. All the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. And you're going to see all these references to death. Verse 14, so all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and he died. So over and over and over again, you know, people are living, from our standards, pretty long lives, but it always ends up in death. So you get the impression here that, you know, died, you know, or death is all over the place. And then, I know I'm jumping ahead of myself here a little bit, because this is more of a promise plan, part three of the story. But Lamech lived 182 years and became a father of a son. Now he called his name Noah, saying, "This one shall give us rest from our work and from the toil of our hands arising from the ground which the Lord has cursed." So, like I said, there's different understandings of that. I tend to think of that as perhaps a messianic expectation, that there's, you know, this. In other words, there's this hope that things are going to get changed, that there's going to be restoration. All right, that leads us to number seven. God's evaluation of man is that he is wicked all the time. So you get to Genesis chapter 6, and we see, you know, as man is multiplied, God is thoroughly frustrated with the sinfulness. Chapter 6, verse 1, it came about when men began to multiply on the face of the land and the daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful. They took wives for themselves, whomever they chose. Then the Lord said, "My spirit shall not strive with man forever, because he is also flesh." And then you look at verse 5. Verse 5 says, "Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." So that's a great total depravity passage there. Every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. So that's God's evaluation of mankind as man has started to, you know, populate, and he's thoroughly frustrated with man. Verse 6 says, "Then the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. The Lord said, 'I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land,'" man and animals, etc., etc. Notice verse 11. Now, of course, the one difference would be here is Noah found grace or favor in the eyes of the Lord. So in the midst of this awful situation, someone finds grace. Noah does. But then in verse 11, "Now the earth was corrupt in the sight of God, and the earth was filled with violence. God looked on the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way upon the earth. Then God said to Noah, 'The end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence because of them, and behold, I am about to destroy them with the earth.'" So, again, God gives a big picture evaluation of mankind. Again, this is all stemming back from Genesis 3, and he's about to wipe man off the face of the earth. All right, we've covered the first 7 points. Anybody have any questions or comments at this point? As we're doing our biblical theology of sin from Genesis 1 to 11. Yes.
with reference to Genesis 6:5 as being descriptive, obviously in the text of kind of the pervasiveness of sin in the hearts of men at the time, does it follow that we can use that text to talk about total depravity now?
I think so. I think we can. In other words, the question is applicability of Genesis 6:5 to today? And I would say yes, because yes in the sense of an overall evaluation of mankind, because what we're seeing played out in the course of history is that at this particular point, the solution to the sin problem hasn't been given yet. And so yes, that would apply. Plus even the characteristics you're seeing about as far as violence and the depravity and all those sorts of things you're seeing that manifested today. Obviously, the point of discontinuity will be with the coming of the Messiah. Remember, because what we're going to be seeing here is as Noah's flood occurs, it leads to the Noahic covenant, and the Noahic covenant ends up being the foundation for the other covenants of promise, because it promises stability of nature. So as the Abrahamic covenant comes, then we're going to have the Davidic and the New Covenant. And what's significant, how that would relate to Genesis 6:5, would be is that when the Messiah comes, he also brings with him the New Covenant ministry of the Holy Spirit and the new heart. So the New Covenant is going to be key, because in Genesis 6:5, it talks about the thoughts of the heart are evil continually. Genesis 6:5 is the promise of a new heart with the indwelling Holy Spirit. So as the Messiah comes and inaugurates the new covenant, those who identify with him, they're not characterized by Genesis 6:5 anymore. So in a sense, you know, even like the Jeremiah 17, but you know, about the heart being desperately sick, that's a true statement for mankind as a whole and for unbelievers. But when a person becomes a believer, they're said they're given a new heart. So in that sense, there'd be a little bit of a qualification.
The total depravity of the heart.
Yeah.
Being that it cannot at all be pleasing to God in any sense unless there's regeneration or new covenant.
Unless there'd be regeneration and the new covenant, right. Plus, I think you even just see that. Jesus in Matthew 24 even talks about it as in the days of Noah. And I know it's in the context of marrying and giving in marriage, but the day of the Lord conditions, of which there's going to be a judgment by fire, parallel the days of Noah in the sense that there's wickedness all over the place. So if you read Isaiah 24, which is talking about the day of the Lord, it might even be good to look at that here. If you look at Isaiah 24, you see why this global tribulation is going to occur. I mean, Isaiah 24:1 says, "Behold, the Lord lays the earth waste, devastates it, distorts its surface, scatters its inhabitants." Verse 3 says, "The earth will be completely laid waste and completely despoiled." Verse 5 says, "The earth is also polluted by its inhabitants, for they transgressed laws, violated statutes, and broke the everlasting covenant. Therefore, a curse devours the earth, and those who live in it are held guilty. Therefore, the inhabitants of the earth are burned, and few men are left." Then it talks about this destruction that's going to come. I think it's actually even interesting there. The mention of the everlasting covenant in verse 5 seems to even go back to Genesis 8 and 9, which is the Noahic covenant is referred to as an everlasting covenant. So it's kind of interesting is that when you're getting ready for the day of the Lord, what I would still even see as future from the standpoint, the description of mankind is pretty similar to the days of Noah. So the answer would be, for the most part, yes. Very strong link with Genesis 6:5. All right, any other questions or thoughts? Yes.
Just before that, but I was just very curious about the Noahic covenant. As I read it, I'm seeing basically just promise not to destroy the world again, same way, and just a recommissioning to do what Adam was told to do and fill the earth.
Yeah.
You say there, so his kingdom salvation plan can play out.
Yeah.
You're just saying that's implied. It's not really saying that there is. It's not explicitly saying that
Does the salvation kingdom plan will play out?
It's not really like a messianic, a direct messianic sort of reference in the Noah.
Well, I think it's related to it. And part of it will be because of canonical connections. I mean, to me, the way that the Noahic covenant comes into play is that, again, remember, put yourself in the shoes of those just coming off the global flood. The flood has been like an uncreation. All the distinctions that were taking place at creation, including the land and the water, have been obliterated. So there literally is a sense when you get off the ark, you don't know what's what. I mean, everything's been turned upside down. So as part as I make the statement, I think later passages of scripture will indicate this, because you'll end up seeing references to the Davidic and New Covenants being linked with the Noahic Covenant later on. So I tend to, now there's several promises of the Noahic Covenant, but I tend to view it primarily as God's promise of stability of nature, so that the promise plan of Genesis 3:15 and the kingdom plan and the salvation plan can play out in history. So there's going to be, that's what coming out of the talk of the seasons, you know, day and night, and the seasons are going to occur, which means there's going to be there's going to be a long period of time of things working right.
Covenant was actually the tilting of the earth on its axis, producing seasons. Because if the earth was a vertical axis, we wouldn't have seasons.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not so sure about the that could be. But as far as there's no doubt that I believe that the flood brought pretty big changes as far as even potentially involving the seasons and those sorts of things. As far as but the fact that it's, when you look at chapter 8 and it talks about, while the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. That's indicating a long period of time of nature working in a way that man can depend on it. Now, that'll be one of the things that's interesting about the day of the Lord is, as you're dealing with that day of the Lord and the birth pangs of that, which bring you to the messianic kingdom, there is going to be almost like a cosmic dissolving again. So just as the water and all that caused upheaval and people to be in chaos, when there's cosmic signs and earthquakes and plagues and all that sort of stuff, man's going to be in chaos again. But even then, the purpose isn't for the annihilation of the planet, but for the kingdom that will break forth as a result of that and the restoration of all things.
If we with the other covenants,
yeah.
Davidic, Abrahamic.
Yeah.
What elements of the Noahic covenant do you see in those?
Well, it'll be, you'll find references to, I'll have to look for the specific reference. There's a few in Jeremiah, but you'll have references to my servant David and the Davidic covenant, and then the covenant of peace that God's going to make with his people, and then it'll be linked with the creation, with the stability of nature, and the sun, the moon, the stars, and those sorts of things. So, and I'll have to look those references up, but there's actually one passage in Jeremiah that has the Noahic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, the Davidic covenant, and the New Covenant, and even the priestly covenant, all in the same passage. So that's what's going to be interesting later, is seeing those connections. So that's what I think it's worthy to say that the Noahic covenant does several things, but it's also a platform for the fulfilling of the kingdom program. But remind me to look at those, get those passages for you, because I need to show you those. Right, any other questions or thoughts so far? All right, so that brings us to point 8, which would be that God destroys a sinful world with a global flood. So that's Genesis 7 to 8. The flood happens because of sinfulness. So, and of course, that will be used in 2 Peter 3, when people are mocking, when mockers are saying, where's the promise of his coming? Peter's going to say in 2 Peter 3, hey, God has done this before. He has destroyed the world with water. There is a coming day of the Lord, purging fire that is coming, global. Number 9, God promises not to destroy sinful man, so his kingdom salvation plan can play out via the Noahic covenant. So I've already explained that a little bit. But the Noahic covenant comes off of the global flood. I mean, if you look in Genesis 8:20, then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took of every clean animal and of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. So significant here that you end up having burnt offerings in connection with the Noahic covenant. And so we'll see, you also see that with the Abrahamic covenant. Let's just put it this way. The Noahic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, and the new covenant will all have blood shed in regard to the ratification of those covenants. Verse 21, the Lord smelled the soothing aroma, and the Lord said to himself, I will never again curse the ground on account of man, for the intent of man's heart is evil from his youth, and I will never again destroy every living thing as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest and cold and heat and summer and winter and day and night shall not cease. So I think that's the, like I said, the perpetuity of nature, that it's going to be a long time where the earth goes with stability, and that will allow the other covenants to play out. Yeah.
You know, for someone who cannot, who doesn't affirm the total depravity, looking at Noah as the stereotype of man that is not totally depraved, all the rest was depraved, but not Noah. He found favor before God.
Yeah.
It's incredible that this statement comes after the flood, the judging, because who was left on earth? Just Noah. And God says, the evil, the third man are evil. So it's still in Noah.
Yeah.
God is affirming the total depravity.
That's going to be established very quickly, that even after the cleansing of the flood, man's heart still needs to be fixed. So that's quite an object lesson there. Okay, then number 10. Now again, remember, as I'm doing these things, I'm focusing on the doctrine of sin. There's so many other doctrinal implications we could be going to, but I'm just focusing on the sin issue. Noah's sin shows he's not the promised deliverer. And so, you know, as I remember back in Genesis 5:28-29, Noah's father thought that he might be the one that would reverse the curse. Now, as I mentioned, not everybody agrees on that understanding. I've even read a commentator who said, you know, that Noah's father was expecting him to help around the house and in the fields and all that. I think it's, like I said, I think it's more than that. As I told you before, I think the Genesis 3:15 promises a seed of the woman who will defeat the power behind the serpent, and it talks about a he will bruise your head, you shall, you know, strike him in the heel. So, and then my personal opinion is, and there's some good scholarship who would support this too, like Walter Kaiser and I think Gentry at Southern would argue that when you get to Genesis 4:1, when Eve says, I've gotten a man, even the Lord, that there was the expectation, that there may have been the expectation that even Cain was the deliverer. So perhaps more than just I've gotten help when it comes to having a child, but actually there could be a messianic expectation. There could be a messianic expectation in Genesis 5:28-29. So I think I've told you before that I'm a big fan of the concept of a specific messianic hope in the Old Testament. But when you come to Genesis 9:18 and following, the story has often been puzzling to people. And we know there's going to be huge theological implications when you get to Noah's three sons and then the people groups that are going to come from Noah's three sons. That's a whole issue in and of itself. But it's, you come to this account where the Noah gets drunk. You know, verse 20 says, Noah began farming and planted a vineyard. He drank of the wine and became drunk, uncovered himself inside his tent. Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father. So there's this awkward situation. And, you know, Shem and Japheth took a garment, laid it upon their shoulders, walked backwards, covered the nakedness of their father. Their faces were turned away so they did not see their father's nakedness. I mean, this is a kind of a weird, not good situation, obviously under the sovereignty of God, but it's obviously, like I said, the implications for the sons of Noah are going to come out of this, but I think it's fair to note, as others have pointed out, that this account of the sinfulness of Noah is a reminder that even with Noah, the one who found grace, he's still a sinner, and thus he's not the promised one. I mean, he's not the deliverer. He's a great man. He obviously is part of one of the hugest events in the history of the world, you know, being involved with the ark that saved mankind at that particular point. But he too is a sinner. You know, some have pointed out, you know, and they've even used language that Noah's like a second Adam. There's a sense in which he's also representative of mankind at this particular point. He's the leader of mankind. Some have pointed out that he has parallels with Adam in the sense of being involved with agriculture and gardening and that sort of thing. And also like Adam, you know, as he's the head of the race at this particular point, he ends up sinning and being a failure. So if it is true that from Genesis 3:15 there is a messianic hope, of which I think there is, this would reaffirm that this Noah's found favor and he's been used mightily by God, but he's not the one, so the search continues. So I think it's possible that within the people of God, there's the expectation, is he the one? Perhaps. Then you find out, no, he's not the one. So it's going to be true with Abraham. Abraham, he's chosen by God, but we also see that he's a sinner. David comes on the scene. The seed line runs through David, but he's a sinner. And of course, we see that with, you know, Isaac and Jacob, and all these people in the seed line end up doing something to show that they're not the final savior. And then number 11, even after the flood, mankind continues to rebel against God, as evidenced by the Tower of Babel event. So you come to Genesis 11. Now again, remember, it is quite interesting that Genesis 10 lists Noah's sons and the people groups before you get to the Tower of Babel event. I mean, you might think the Tower of Babel event should come first, but it actually comes after the list of people groups. Why is that the case? We don't know for sure. I've leaned towards the argument that several have made that this may show the fact that the Tower of Babel event comes after a list of people groups may go to show that we can't just say variety of people groups is just solely a result of sin and is a negative thing. Obviously, the development of the multiplying of the earth and the people groups is going to be a result of the Tower of Babel. But it may also be part of God's plan from the beginning for man to multiply and fill the earth, that he intended for there to be diversity of people groups throughout the world. But anyway, when you come to Genesis 11, you know, we're, you know, clearly dealing with post-flood, but things aren't much better. We still see sin. Now the whole earth used the same language and the same words, and it came about as they journeyed east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. They said to one another, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they used brick for stone and they used tar for mortar. And then we see what they're all about. They said, come, let us build for ourselves a city and a tower whose top will reach into heaven, and let us make for ourselves a great name. So they want to make for themselves a great name. Otherwise, we will be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. Now notice, they don't want to scatter, but what did God want done? He told both Adam and Noah, I want you to get going, you know, fill the earth. So this is just straight out rebellion. I mean, they're not doing the multiply and fulfill command. They want to stay in one spot. No, so they also want to make a name for themselves. I think I've told you this before. God's not always against making people a great name. He's going to tell Abraham and David, I'm going to make you a great name. But it has to be on his terms, not people just deciding for themselves that they're going to do it their way. So this is obviously rebellion. So verse 5 says, The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. The Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they all have the same language, and this is what they begin to do. And now nothing which they purpose to do will be impossible for them. And so what happens is he comes down and he confuses their languages, and then verse 8 tells us that the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of the whole earth. So God even uses this sinful event to accomplish his purposes, which is to get man to spread out over the earth. So we see that even after the flood, mankind continues to rebel against God, as evidenced by the Tower of Babel event. So when you come to the end of chapter 11, you know, I give you a little summary here. The foundational chapters of Genesis 1 to 11 reveal that sin is a major problem for mankind. So I mean, we see that, right? I mean, what we just went over, it's like sin is a huge deal. I don't know about you, but I personally think it's helpful to do that survey because it helps show. I mean, there's all these interesting stories, which we would say are true, not using story and fictional, but there's all these interesting stories in Genesis, but one thing that just seems to be just totally connecting almost all of this is just that sin is a major problem. Why is there the flood? It's because of sin. Why is there the Tower of Babel event? It's because of sin. Well, how about Noah? He's a great man, but then he has this sinful, you know, so you just get this, you get this impression, it's pretty heavy. You come to the end of Genesis 11 and you're like, oh, you know, this man's just a mess. So where the hope, well, I'll continue with this and then I'll make some other statements. So the foundational chapters of Genesis 1 to 11 reveal that sin is a major problem for mankind. Even the global flood did not remove it, since sin dwells in the hearts of men. The search for a deliverer and savior continues. God's plan for deliverance will start to take shape through Abraham and the Abrahamic covenant with the events of Genesis 12. So thus, Genesis 10 and 11 is the big, how did we get people groups and nations? When you get to the end of Genesis 11, you have the introduction of Abram, who will soon be Abraham, and thus, the connecting point between Genesis 11 and 12, you go from nations down, the nations bring us this person, Abram, and from when you hit Genesis 12, from Abram is going to be Abraham and then the developing people of Israel who are supposed to be the means for blessing the whole earth. So, which brings us to the important realization that although we rightly distinguish Genesis 1 to 11 from Genesis 12 to 50, they are very closely interlinked in the sense that when you hit Genesis 12, it's not like God's going to say, forget the world, it's all about Israel now. Don't care about everybody else. No, we see here that the reason why God's going to pick Abraham and then this nation Israel is so that this can be part of the salvation kingdom plan to bless all the people groups of the world. That obviously will tie in with Genesis 12, 3. And you, all the families of the earth, shall be blessed. So, I guess as you're looking at this from a biblical theology perspective, Genesis 1 to 11 leaves you very heavy. It leaves almost frustrated. It's like sin is just this awful thing that just keeps plaguing mankind. But then when you come to Genesis 12, you start to see how God's going to start to deal with this. He's going to start with Abraham and then go from there. All right. Any questions or thoughts on a biblical theology of sin from Genesis 1 to 11, or anything you want to talk about? Okay. All right. Now, I suppose, you know, I mean, obviously we could do just a biblical theology of sin. Of course, we would, like when I update this, maybe someday I'll update this from Genesis 1 to 11 to just the Bible. But I would say that, obviously, which... I'm just thinking off the top of my head, but like it's, yeah, go ahead.
You mentioned the potential of sin in Genesis 2.
Yes.
Because we have positive commands, multiply, wouldn't that be a potential of sin to not multiply, to not subdue, versus the negative, do not eat of the fruit of the tree?
Yeah, was there the potential to disobey it at that particular time? Yeah, the command to do something would have the implications for the not doing it. Yeah, I mean, I guess that's true. I mean, there does seem to be something specifically about the Genesis 2:15 as far as the specificity of it and that sort of thing. And so, I guess you would. We do know from Genesis 2:15 that the possibility for sin seems to be there from the beginning, and so. I guess hypothetically that would probably be true for that as well. All right, any other questions or thoughts? But I was going to say, like, if we ended up adding to the list, I think what you'd probably, and I'll try to do this, but I guess the key would be is that when you hit Genesis 12 and following, you're getting the promised seed line. You're getting Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So that's going to be part of the development of the Genesis 3:15 of the seed of the woman. And we're now going to see it's going to be including Abraham and his seed. But I think what you'll see there is you'll end up seeing those patriarchs, they will still sin. They're still the promised line, but they will still sin. When you get to Israel, what are you going to have? You're going to end up having the giving of the Mosaic Law. But what's the Mosaic Law going to do? It's going to reveal Israel's sin. And so, you know, Paul will state that on many occasions, that there's the Mosaic Law reveals sin. So when you get through the whole Old Testament, you still see that sin is a major issue. But then you start to get some prophetic passages. Obviously, Isaiah 52 and Isaiah 53 would be key, because there's the promise of an ultimate Israelite who's going to end up providing atonement for the nations. So those would be some other things that would be included. But I'll see if I can come up with a total theology from Genesis to Revelation. All right. Yeah.
If the commands to multiply, rule, and subdue are still in effect to some extent, you know, how do we view that? I'm thinking of an example for each one of those. You know, to multiply, we see people like Hannah, who God had closed her womb, she was unable to have kids. Ruling in the New Testament, it talks about those that are slaves to be subject to their masters. Yeah. So they don't have the ability to rule over almost anything.
Yeah.
So do we have, you know, Paul being a tent maker, it doesn't feel like he's really doing much to subdue the earth.
Yeah, right.
You know, how do we live out those commands in some situations where maybe you're not able to by your circumstances or incapable of doing so based on God's...
That's great. In other words, the present applicability of it. And as I give that answer, I would base it in the truths of Hebrews 2. So you're asking a good question there. If the command is the Genesis 1:26-28 to multiply and to rule and subdue, what does that mean for now, particularly since it doesn't seem to happen very well? I would say, before I make my comments, like I said, I'll just read Hebrews 2:5-8, where in Hebrews 2:5-8 it says, "For he, God, did not subject to angels the world to come." So notice he's talking about a world to come, which would be post-second coming of Jesus. Angels aren't going to rule over it. They were never intended to rule over it, but man will. "So he did not subject to angels the world to come, concerning which we are speaking, but one has testified somewhere, saying," and then this is a quote from Psalm 8, "What is man that you remember him, or the son of man that you are concerned about him? You have made him for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, and have appointed him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet." This is a quotation of Psalm 8, which is a commentary on Genesis 1:26-28. So what's interesting is if you put Psalm 8, 4-8, and Hebrews 2 together, it's still affirming the rule subdue mandate for man. But it brings up exactly your question, which is we don't see it, and man can't do it. And that's where the next part comes in verse 8. "For in subjecting all things to him, he left nothing that is not subject to him, but now we do not yet see all things subjected to him." In other words, we don't see it today, which is exactly what you just brought up. So what I would say is that there, I think we have to, this is part of understanding the kingdom program and where we're at in the kingdom program. I mean, we are living in the post-first coming of Messiah, but pre-second coming, but it's at the second coming that you see the ruling of the earth mandate fulfilled. It's not for now. So in other words, we still live in a fallen world. We still live in an era where Satan is free to do what he does. We still live in a world where we have sons of the evil one next to the sons of the kingdom. So my short answer would be is that the ruling and subduing mandate is not being fulfilled today, and it can't be fulfilled until Jesus comes. And with that, I would tie in 1 Corinthians 15. Because Jesus, with federal headship, ends up being linked with the fulfill mandate. First Corinthians 15:25 says he must reign until he puts all his enemies under his feet. So that's a ruling, right? "The last enemy that will be abolished is death, for he has put all things in subjection under his feet," which is a quote from Psalm 8. But when he says all things are put in subjection, you know, God would be the one who would be, the Father would be an exception to that. "And then when all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subject to the one who has subjected all things to him." What I think is also interesting about this is the same chapter that refers to Jesus as the Adam. The first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. So this is how I would put it together. The Genesis 1 tasks man to rule and subdue. Because of the fall, it's a failure. So everything pre-second coming is going to fail in that regard. But because of Jesus, who's the last Adam, with his first coming, he sets the cosmic basis for the restoration of all things with his death, Colossians 1:20. But when he comes again, that's when he reigns, and then those who identify with him will reign. So the answer would be, how do we as believers right now understand our mission? I think the New Testament indicates our mission is taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. We're calling on people to become citizens of the kingdom, that when it comes, they'll be a part of it. And then I would also draw your attention to Revelation 5:10, where it talks about those who have identified with Jesus. You know, this is talking about those who have been saved from every people group. It says in Revelation 5:10 that they will reign upon the earth. Isn't that interesting? I mean, that's a church, that's a statement for those living in this church age. You know, this is written in the 90s, that the saints will reign upon the earth. They're not reigning on the earth now, but they will. So I know that was kind of a long-winded answer, but the answer to the question is we don't reign over the earth right now. Hebrews 2 says we don't see these things being subjected to man yet. It's for the world to come, and Jesus will do it. That's what come there has to be a millennial kingdom. That's what come the other millennial views can't be right, because they end up having Jesus ruling and reigning from heaven, which was never Adam's task. Jesus is going to reign over the earth. Those who identify with him will be reigning. So I think the key there is understanding our place in the story. Which is, I was thinking of this today. This is where, I guess it's dangerous to put up a chart when you just think of it a couple hours ago. But I was just thinking of this, like the Genesis 1, 26 to 28 has man ruling from earth over earth. Or at least he's supposed to. Adam was created, he was put in the garden, he's on the earth, now rule and subdue it. Okay? I think what's interesting is, if you look at amillennialism is going to say that Jesus is the last Adam, Jesus is reigning from heaven over a spiritual kingdom. You know, if you're amillennial, you believe the millennium is today. You believe Jesus is ruling from David's throne today. So what's interesting about that is even though Adam was tasked with ruling from the earth over the earth, they have Jesus reigning from heaven over a spiritual kingdom. And usually for them, the kingdom would either be regeneration and salvation, or the reign would be the intermediate state of saints in heaven. So for some, they would actually say the reign of the saints is in heaven in the intermediate state. How does that relate to Adam's task? This mandate that he was given was from the earth over the earth. Amillennialism is putting it from heaven over a spiritual kingdom. If you have post-mill, the post-millennial view, they actually have a reign from heaven over an earthly kingdom. I'll put it this way, a reign from heaven that does involve earth. Because one thing about post-millennialism is they do believe that the messianic work of Christ transforms society. So for them, it is more earth-related. I mean, post-millennialists are expecting this world to be transformed culturally, socially, economically, in every way. And on that, I applaud them. They're right, but I think they get the timing wrong because they're trying to put that before the second coming. I don't see any evidence for that in Scripture. So in this sense, it's a little better. They're wrong in that it's a rain from heaven. They're right in that it involves the earth. But the pre-mill view is the only one that gets the reign of the last Adam, the last Adam and his saints reign from and over the earth. Jesus said in Matthew 5, the humble, the meek will inherit the earth. Revelation 5:10, they shall reign upon the earth. So that's what come, I think, here, that there's a strong connection between Genesis 1, 26 to 28 and Revelation 20. So anyway, first Adam was to rule from the earth over the earth. Failure. He fails. And we're still experiencing that failure. Jesus comes and he succeeds. Success. And what happens when that success takes place? 1 Corinthians 15, 24 to 28. When he's reigned, what does he do? He hands the kingdom over to the Father. He hands the kingdom over to the Father, which appears to be the reward. The eternal state is the reward for the successful reign. This one here?
Yeah.
Rain from heaven, but it involves the earth. So that's involved. So in other words, post-mills are, they believe the messianic reign transforms society. On this particular case, post-mills and pre-mills have some similarities. They both believe the earth has to be transformed because of what Christ does. This puts it at before the second coming, and the pre-mill puts it as a result of the second coming. Now, when you read the Amills, and particularly if you read like Hokama, I mean, they believe that it ends up being confusing because they believe the world's getting worse and worse during this age in which they're right, but then they still also talk about transforming society, and it's kind of a mix that doesn't make sense to me. But anyway, I don't know if anybody has any questions or thoughts on that, but yep.
Now, these are obviously tight categories. Is there a way to think about like a reign of Christ in heaven now, as an inaugurated Davidic reign?
I'd say no. I mean, some do, and even some dispensationalists do. I would just say I think the evidence doesn't indicate it. I mean, to me, what's happening is Psalm 110:1. The Lord said to my Lord, to David's Lord, sit in my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. And then he's going to reign from Zion. So I think what's taking place today is Jesus has been exalted to the right hand of the Father. He shares the throne of deity with the Father. And in doing so, he has Matthew 28, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. And if there ends up being an already aspect of his reign, there is a sense in which when it comes to dealing with the spiritual forces of wickedness and stuff, there's statements there of his authority in that realm. So you do see that. But I think the Hebrews 10, 12 to 13 is really significant because it says he's sitting at the right hand of the Father waiting from that time until he begins his reign. So the issue you're bringing up, that's a very good issue to think through. I guess I would just say to this is that, yeah, Jesus in Matthew 19:28 and Matthew 25:31 tells you when he sits on the glorious throne. It's at the time of the regeneration of the earth when the apostles are ruling the 12 tribes of Israel. And then in Matthew 25:31, when he comes in glory, when he comes in glory with his angels, then he will sit on his throne. So it seems like there's multiple statements of Jesus saying it's in the future. Okay. All right. So, like I said, this is one of those issues where you get a strong intersect between anthropology and then eschatology. I mean, this is a big deal. I mean, when you think of what the post-mills and the pre-mills are saying. This has everything to do with the church's mission, doesn't it? I mean, this is the issue. This is how people say, well, does eschatology matter? Yeah, it matters. It matters a lot. I mean, it matters in regard to the role of the church. I mean, is it the church's role to transform society and Christianize this world before Jesus comes? That's a huge thing to think through. I mean, to me, the answer is no. the church's mission is gospel proclamation, and we're looking forward to the time when he comes again and we participate in that reign upon the earth. But this affects the church's mission.